It's interesting, though, when I mentioned the internet, the access to information and communication, that desire was already there. It's not like sometimes you invent something and people see them, and after a while the interest in them grows and people are like, yeah, maybe I do need one of those. You know, like, for a long time in human history, people cooked without blenders. It wasn't like early man was thinking, you know what I wish I could do? I wish I could stick the meat and the vegetables in this thing and puree it. There wasn't a market, but the market developed. Access to information, though, when they first brought the telegraph lines from Europe to North America, the first day's worth of information that pumps through those telegraph lines was incredible. The desire to communicate ideas was so strong already. If you went back to the 1800s and handed everybody cell phones and gave them a little bit of time to learn them, they'd be using them probably as much as people today do, because they want to talk. They want the info. They're info junkies like us. Now, maybe we're a little more info junkie because we've been using them for a while and we're used to, okay, what's my daily batch of cool information I can read before I have my coffee? But people read newspapers in the 1800s.
Yeah. I think someone once pointed out that, you know, if they had computers like this back then, absent any other issues with that, people like the founding fathers of the United States or all these 18th, 19th century intellectuals, they'd be bloggers.
Yeah. Yeah, but they might not have run for office. They'd be blogging instead.
I don't mean the ones who ran for office.
Yeah, among the consequences of this incredible access to communication, which may not have been intended, is often we're told, you know, oh, they're starving. You know, there was a big thing of eat your dinner and there's starving kids in Africa. You know, and the kid would always joke, well, send them this crap, I don't want to eat it. But now, sometimes when you hear about somebody in a part of the world that's afflicted by whatever disaster, you might actually know people in that country. When the tsunami hit the Indian Ocean, a friend of mine from, I think it was Thailand, was going to the beach that week. So she was offline for 2 weeks or something. And so for an entire week, I didn't know if this person I knew was killed. It wasn't just these abstract other people in the other part of the world, you know, those people we hear about. Because we did get news before that instant communication system. This was somebody I knew, and knew fairly well, even though I'd never met them. They turned out to be fine, but, you know, more than 100,000 people didn't in that case. And this access to communication is humanizing a lot of these other people, I think. Sometimes in a bad way, because sometimes people see the differences and start arguing over, you know, the differences in the way the cultures go. But in other cases, it's like you start to realize this is a person, right? And even if I might argue, you know, I prefer this political system versus that political system, you still want to help them out if it's more so when it's somebody you know, I think. So I think unintended consequences of this communication is making things a little better. Steve Pinkerton talks about the decline of violence. Some people have taken issue with some of the specifics, but he said if you look century by century, decade by decade, millennia by millennia, the total amount of violence per capita is going way down. And we don't know why. And I think some of it is you can relate to other people more. When you pick up a novel, somebody reads Oliver Twist, suddenly it's not, oh, that's those street urchins out there. All they do is complain and try and steal your food and they make a mess on the street and all that. You read Oliver Twist, you're right inside the mind of that person who lives on the street. Because was it Darwin who wrote it?
Dickens.
Darwin. Sorry?
Dickens.
Dickens, yeah, I'm mixing Dickens and Darwin up. Dickens put you inside the mind of somebody else in a brilliant way. And I think that ability to relate to other humans is part of what's causing the decline of violence. They aren't just an enemy, they aren't just an other. They're somebody you can relate to inside their mind. And I think this access we have to communicate with anybody in the world, anywhere, on any topic, is continuing to drive that. Now, we definitely have problems too. There are some irreconcilable differences politically in the world, there are, you know, religious-wise, there are some philosophical ideas that some people, and that can lead to some pretty good arguments. But as long as it's leading to good arguments and not to violence, that's good. Somebody wants to go on the internet and say, I think you're a savage because you hold down your 13-year-old daughter and cut her genitals up, I think that's way better than just going to war over it. And maybe the war of ideas will lead to some of those bad things being improved upon. Maybe not. Maybe the war of ideas will lead to people digging their heels in and saying, no, I'm going to keep doing this because, you know, they have access to information on why their culture or religion says to do that as well. So, but I think if we can get the idea or the war of ideas to more an exchange of ideas and less of a battle, it'll probably improve things even more.
And it's actually even changing anthropology. Mm-hmm. Now when anthropologists study civilizations, they look at the exchange of ideas as being a separate kind of exchange, aside from things like trade or marriage routes. Mm-hmm. So not just in today's terms where we have tons of exchange technologies, they're looking back like hundreds of years ago and looking at people in like medieval France or something and saying there was an ideas trade going on that was different from any other trade, that had its own characteristics. Mm-hmm. And they're looking for traits like that in it to point out how people were thinking differently.
Yeah, that works. And while I don't think every idea is equal in merit, I think there is a good advantage to exchanging ideas and new ways of thought. There is a tendency, because I like the idea of respecting multiple ways of thinking, to mistake that with all the ways of thinking are equally good. Like I said, I don't think it's a good idea to hack up a girl's genitals. I think it's a bad idea inherently. I will think about what led to it. You know, I might consider, you know, why does this happen? Was there some thought process other than what evil can I do today, which I think it was beyond that. But I think it's a bad idea. But at the same time, that doesn't mean every single idea or the groups of people with that idea as part of their culture is a bad idea. And if we can exchange, find the good parts of it, and in looking at another culture and going, I really think that's bad, well, wait a minute, I better be introspective too and look at my own culture, say, well, what might we be doing that's bad that should be improved as well? What ideas might I have that looked at from outside might be very bad, and do they have a point? And I want to consider that point.
Yeah, that's basically, it's a free exchange of, facilitating the free exchange of ideas and the introspection of those ideas. It's a good way to figure out what is good and what is bad, because it's not, they're not self-evident ideas.
Yeah, usually. Yeah. And that, I think, that interest in the desire to recognize the other as something that has some value and some worth consideration has led in some cases to, well, you shouldn't criticize other cultures. Yeah. And I think, yeah, I should. To me, I think I should. If I think they're doing something evil, I think I should bring that up and explain why I think it's evil and for consideration. And if they say, well, there's this mitigating point that you didn't consider, and I'm like, oh, you know, I didn't know that. I think I'll modify my point of view, if they're right. If not, I hope they do the same. And I think, well, you know, I never really thought about that as evil, but maybe it is. So, but that desire to not appear bigoted, to not say, I hate their idea because it's different. Like, some people from the West would go to some cultures and go, oh my God, their women aren't wearing shirts. They're savages. They're horrible evil beasts because their women aren't wearing shirts. Well, so what? There's nothing evil about that. You know, if you think about it, it's like you might feel a little awkward if you're not used to seeing people naked or topless. So what? Think about it, see, oh, wait a minute, my feeling of awkwardness doesn't necessitate that what they're doing is evil. Now, in some cases, now, if they're beating their kids up continuously, and you think, well, maybe in their culture it's okay to beat your kids up. Well, maybe it shouldn't be. They are two different things. But if you, in the desire to so respect the other, gets to the point where you're unwilling to judge evil when you see it, then I think that's a bad unintended consequence. If you're so used to judging evil when you see it in other cultures that you're seeing everything about the other culture, such as, oh, they wear different clothes than us, or they paint their hair a different color than I'm used to, and that must be evil too, because to me they're all associated, that's a bad unintended consequence as well. So it's a good free exchange of ideas, introspection, question, and question yourself as hard as you question everyone else, I think, is one of the ways to get around that.